Welcome to Networking and Health Information Exchange, Health Data Interchange Standards. This is Lecture B. The objectives for this lecture are to understand HL7 version 3.0 messaging standards, learn about the HL7 version 3 reference information model, RIM, understand what is different about HL7 version 3 compared to version 2.n, and understand the HL7 version 3 domains. The HL7 version 3 family of standards is based on an explicit reference model and a defined methodology development framework. Many HL7 version 3 standards are based on the MDF and have in common the explicit information model. This lecture focuses on the version 3 messaging standard. Other HL7 version 3 standards are discussed in subsequent units. Version 3 is based on an explicit information model. Interoperability among unrelated, heterogeneous sites can only be accomplished through the use of a common information reference model. The most commonly used information model is the HL7 RIM. There are other models available, including the CEN or ISO standard 13606. This model is abstract, that is, it is defined without regard to how it is represented in a message, on the wire, or in a service architecture method, or in a clinical document. In fact, each of these representations can contain the same instance of information. The RIM defines the basic things. See Lecture 5A. Or nouns and the relationship or linkages among those things or phrases. At the basic level, the RIM defines entities and acts and includes the role of the entity, the participation of the entity with the act, and the act relationship. If the RIM becomes the basis for the identification of data elements and is used in the exchange of data, two unconnected groups can, through the common RIM, understand and use the data. With the RIM, two groups given the same use case should derive similar messages to exchange the data. Further, the RIM permits the extension of concepts to support new domains without changing the old.
All HL7 version 3 products are based on the RIM CDA, Decision Support, Messages, and Others. Domain analysis models define information flow, workflow, and identify associated data elements within a clinical domain. Communications between domains requires an abstract domain-independent model, such as the HL7 RIM. Exchange of data among domains using version 3.0 is based on the RIM to establish interoperability. In other words, the exchange of data starts with the reference information model and ends with the reference information model. It is the link that establishes the structure for interoperability. Cross-reference tables build the mappings from the narrow world of the individual domain to the cross-domain interoperability supported by the HL7 RIM. The HL7 RIM, in its simplest form, includes these nouns and phrases. There are 6 RIM core or backbone classes: entity, role, role link, participation, act, and act relationship. Examples of an entity include organization, place, person and non-person, living subject and material. Material is composed of manufactured material, which includes container and device. Roles include such things as patient, employee, licensed entity, qualified entity, and access. Role link is defined by a type code. Participation ties the entity in a specific role to the act. Examples of participation linkages include managed participation. ACT represents the verbs of the model. ACT includes a class code and a mood code, which identifies the status of the act, such as ordered, result, etc. Examples of the ACT class are document, which encompasses context structure, working list, device task, control act, patient encounter, exposure, supply, which also includes diet, procedure, which also includes substance administration, account, observation, which also includes diagnostic image and public health case, invoice element, financial transaction, and financial contract. ACT relationships include components and supported by whom. It is defined by a type code. The HL7 development framework defines the methodology for mapping a local domain system into a common reference model, in this case, the HL7 RIM. This mapping uses the UML-based domain analysis model, which is created by the domain experts. A DAM helps answer the questions, what do you do? What data elements do you use? What is the data flow? And what are the decision points? So the domain experts create the DAM for that clinical domain, and then it is mapped into the RIM. The mapping is bidirectional. In other words, the RIM may show required changes in the local system as reflected in the domain, and the DAM may show additional requirements for the RIM. Those requirements are added to the RIM through a harmonization process. In any case, this process will yield the required interoperability. RIM harmonization is a continuous process, although at this stage, the changes to the RIM are slight and few. HL7 standards, both V2 and V3, are grouped into 7 reference categories. Primary standards are those standards that are an essential part of what is required for systems integration. These are the most popular and therefore the most frequently used standards. Fundamental standards define standards that provide the basic building blocks for all other standards. These standards are used in the creation of other standards. The fundamental standards define the personality and characteristics of HL7 standards. Clinical and administrative standards focus on the user domains in the administrative and clinical areas. EHR profiles define functional models for the EHR and include the functionality requirements for target audiences. Implementation guides define how to use specific standards for specific purposes. All implementation guides are linked to a parent standard. Rules and references are not really standards, but provide structures and guidelines for software and standards development. Education and awareness include the category of standards known as Draft Standards for Trial Use, DSTU. Ideally, all standards would go through a testing or trial stage before they move into permanent status as a normative standard. An increasing number of standards in HL7 are model-based. The HL7 framework includes RIM, data types, data elements, vocabulary, templates, and clinical statements. All of these elements involve defining the data in a semantic, interoperable way. The resulting model-based standards include Version 3 Messaging, CDA, GELLO, and System-Oriented Architecture. The GELLO language can be used to build up expressions to extract and manipulate data from medical records, construct decision criteria by building up expressions to reason about particular data features or values. These criteria can be used in decision support knowledge bases, such as those designed to provide alerts and reminders, guidelines, or other decision rules. Create expressions, formula, etc. for other applications. We will learn more about GELLO in the next unit. What's different about V3? It is a conceptual foundation, a single common reference information model to be used across HL7. V3 has as its goal and purpose interoperability. It is a semantic foundation, explicitly defined concept domains drawn from the best terminologies. As previously noted, it is based on the RIM, which provides the fundamental underpinnings for interoperability. The language of data interchange, explicitly defined concept domains expressed as data elements with standardized terminology, provide the required semantic foundation. It is an abstract design methodology that is technology neutral, able to be used with whatever is the technology du jour, for example, XML, UML, etc. The design methodology that creates the technology-neutral messages permits the use of different technologies and permits an evolution over time as technology varies. It may be used to maintain a repository or database of the semantic content to assure a single source and enable development of support tooling. Finally, V3 supports a repository of semantic content or terminology and data elements and tools. The repository of common components for the semantic base are maintained in an HL7 model repository. These include such things as the RIM, vocabulary, storyboards, interaction models, message designs, and message constraints. Tools support the management of the HL7 model repository. Tools also support semantic specifications, abstract information structures that are used in messages, templates, and documents. Tools also support the publication of HL7 standards and implementation guides. The transition from V2 to V3 has been slow in the U.S. for many reasons. First is the fact that V2 meets the current need of many users. The philosophy is, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Secondly, V3 is perceived to be much more complex than V2. The fact is, V3 is a requirement for interoperability in large-scale implementation. If data is to be exchanged in regions, states, and nationally, V3 must come into more widespread use. Data types that provide precise definition of the constructs of more complicated structures and, in particular, accommodate differences in the global setting make this semantic requirement easier. V3 has built-in support for complex data types, supporting universally unique instance identifiers for persons, places, organizations, practitioners, URLs, orders, observations, etc. Name data types such as persons and organizations, time and date-related data type forms, and codes, binding standard vocabularies to RIM attributes. V3's methodology of deriving its models from the RIM also supports semantic interoperability. Finally, increased use of the RIM supports a more widespread adoption. Sharing data across a widespread environment for multiple users and multiple stakeholders is driving V3 adoption. Some features of V3 that support interoperability include structural ontology, which is a coherent set of models or structures guaranteeing semantic interoperability, and reuse based on the RIM and data types with integrated vocabulary support, identifier strategy supporting wide integration, and model and tools-based design and implementation. Finally, sharing decision support applications and knowledge applications is enhanced through a model-driven design. The same information is represented the same way everywhere, using the RIM with the binding to structural and standard vocabularies. HL7 V3 uses an HL7 development framework, HDF, model to develop the V3 message. The components of that development process start with the use case model. The use case model includes a number of scenarios that give an example of a situation or event within the domain of interest. Examples might include a patient coming to the clinic with a rash, a well baby checkup, or a patient with chest pain. We have already discussed the reference information model, RIM. The RIM is available as either an RIM diagram, a literary expression, or as a state machine. The domain information model, DIM, is a refined RIM model that is specific to the domain of interest. The message information model, MIM, defines the content and structure of the message, and the message object diagram, MOD, defines the objects contained in the message. The HDF and the use of these components to create V3 messages will be discussed in the following slides. The hierarchical message description, HMD, lays out the message in a hierarchically structured fashion. Finally, the common message element types, CMETs, are the data structures that provide compound and complex structures. We discussed CMETs in a previous lecture. Basically, CMETs are data structures that define higher-level data elements that include a structure. An example is an address that contains street or PO box, city, state or province, country, and zip code. Shared messages include reusable message segments, as do clinical statements. Version 3 standards include standards for administrative management, accounting and billing, claims and reimbursement, patient administration, personnel management, and scheduling. Note that these domains are similar to what is available in version 2 messages. This slide shows the infrastructure or messaging domains: transmission, message control, query, and master file or registry. The additional areas defined by version 3 messaging include the following. Note that items followed by DSTU are draft standards for trial use. Blood, tissue, and organ, DSTU. Care provision, DSTU. Cardiology, DAM. Clinical decision support. Clinical document, DSTU. Immunization, DSTU. Laboratory, materials management, medical records, DSTU. Medication, DSTU. Observations, orders, pharmacy, DSTU. Public health reporting, regulated products, regulated studies, specimen, and therapeutic devices. The next series of slides show the process or methodology by which HL7 messages are created. These slides are important to you only in understanding what goes behind the messages. The parts of the process will be useful to you in understanding the role of use cases, actors, events, trigger events, interactions, the RIM, models, and message creation. The methodology includes an analysis phase, which includes use case modeling and information modeling, and a design phase, which includes interaction modeling and message design. We start with defining the requirements using use cases to define actors and events. The use case model develops the scope, and the use cases identify actors and events. The use cases become the storybook examples. From a storyboard, the actors, places, and other things are identified, the references, and provide input into the interactions. The domain analysis uses the RIM to create class and state diagrams. The information model draws the initial content from the RIM and models new concepts. The interaction model defines triggers, application rules, interactions, and creates conformance claims. The message design includes the DMIM, RMIM, and the MIM. From this message design, the message object diagram is defined, the content that is exchanged. The products of this process are kept in the reference model repository. The slide shows another view of the total process for creating an abstract message and the links or relationships among the many processes. The use case model is used to create a domain information model, DIM, based on the generic RIM. From the DIM constrained by the RIM, a message information model, MIM, is created. From the use case, the interaction model is derived, and the use case, interaction model, and the MIM creates the refined message information model, RMIM. An example of an RMIM is shown on the next slide. The RMIM includes details of the domain-specific message, expanding the specifics and constraints and relationships. Finally, the hierarchical message description is created using CMETS. This slide shows an example of RMIM for an observation order. Please examine this document carefully. At first glance, it may seem complex, but I think you will find that it is easy to read and is a clear representation of content and relationship. The RMIM is an information structure that represents the requirements for a set of messages. A constrained subset of the RIM may contain additional classes that are cloned from RIM classes. The RMIM contains those classes, attributes, associations, and data types that are needed to support one or more HMDs. A single message can be shown as a particular pathway through the classes within an RMIM. In this example, the author is the physician who orders the test, the performer is the laboratory, the subject is the specimen, and the record target is the patient. CMETs are used to define the data structures of the physician, performer, specimen, and patient. The RMIM defines all of the components and their characteristics for creating the data. The attributes of the RIM components are included. For the observation order, the attributes include the class code, the mood code, ID, and other context-specific data. The attributes of the components are obtained from the RIM. Again, note the color coding identifying entities, roles, and acts. These colors match the colors used in the documentation of the HL7 RIM. This slide shows part of a version 3 message related to an RIM ballot. Note the XML structures shown on this slide. V3 has yet to gain acceptance in the US. This slide shows some of the reasons why that is true. V3 is difficult to implement. That process can be made simpler and easier with tools. Few persons really understand V3. We need good implementation guides. The overhead of a V3 message is too much. 1% of the message is payload, compared to V2, which is about 90 to 95%. The use of delimiters in V2 messages accounts for this difference. No one understands what implementation of V3 messaging means. What do I have to understand to implement a V3 message? Can I just implement a message someone else has created for a given purpose, or must I actually construct every message using the process defined by HL7? We need stability, clarity, and definition of V3 messaging. Some implementers create their own messaging using the HDF process. This is complex and probably not necessary. HL7 has begun to build a library of V3 messages developed by HL7 experts in different areas and clinical domains. How many V3 messages are required to support robust EHR, regional healthcare information organizations, RHIOs, and nationwide health information networks, NHINs? Could we meet data interchange needs with only a few messages with constraint mechanisms? This concludes Lecture B of Health Data Interchange Standards. You learned about developing a model-based data interchange standard in this section. It is just coming into use in the U.S. This section also introduced an approach to planning for what system you need, the development and use of models, and introduced the concept of a reference information model, which becomes the basis for interoperability among heterogeneous systems. HL7 V3 has been implemented significantly outside the U.S., specifically the United Kingdom and Canada. However, these countries also use V2 for many existing implementations.